Today we are going to talk about food and where that food actually goes, how it's broken down, and how we get energy from it. So we have talked before about how we don't really have an energy organ inside of our body, but instead, energy, food, is needed and used by every single cell in our body. And so it's very unique that not a lot of people know actually what happens to our food after we consume it. So let's take a look at our digestive system. So first of all, digestion is included in five different phases. You have the ingestion, movement, mechanical and chemical digestion, absorption, and then elimination. And we'll talk about each and every one of those during today's presentation. So first of all, digestion. The two main types are mechanical and chemical. So first of all, anytime you think of mechanical, you want to think of movement. So that would be things like how you actually chew your food. That would be how your stomach mixes it. That would be how your intestines are going to kind of squeeze it a little bit as it goes through your intestines. Chemical digestion, we have a variety of different types of chemical digestion that happens, but mainly we have enzymes and acids. So different foods are not broken down equally. So this is not to be gross, but sometimes when we have corn, some of that still remains in our stool a day or two after. So carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins, that's what we're taking in, are broken down in a couple of different ways. However, those chemicals, acids and enzymes, are going to help us break that down with the best way possible. So let's first of all talk about the GI tract, also known as the gastrointestinal tract. And so that is basically the digestive tube of where our food all goes to. And so most simply, it includes the mouth, then the esophagus, into the stomach, small intestine, large intestine, and then it is excreted outside of our body. Now, certainly, there's a lot more things that are involved with digestion, but the GI tract is really what where a lot of the digestion and absorption is going to take place. So, the mouth, of course, is where we do a lot of the mechanical digestion, the chewing, the grinding. We're moving it with our tongue. The saliva that we have has water that's naturally going to break stuff down, but also has some enzymes in the saliva. The pharynx is going to be kind of the separator of where our food is supposed to go. The esophagus is the small tube. It's not the one that you can touch. It's kind of tucked behind your trachea. Your stomach is somewhat of a J-shaped structure to where a lot of acids, enzymes, and also some natural bacteria are found that help us with digestion. Sometimes students get small and large intestines mixed up. Think of not the length, but think of the diameter. So the small intestine is the pink one here with the smaller circumference, the smaller diameter, and then the larger one is the just that's the larger diameter one, and it's also where our bowel will be created. And then finally the rectum, which is where the bowel will be stored until we finally excrete it. So the mouth. Teeth are very, very important. Our tongue is super important, and the saliva is really, really important. Collectively, those things help make the food basically smaller. It also helps to make sure that it actually moistens it, the kind of that initial moisture that takes place. And so, especially with more of our complex like starches, it's really important that we get those into smaller bits and it's easier to process. And it's also quicker to process. And then also we have something called an epiglottis that is kind of the flap-like structure that basically makes sure that the food goes down the right tube. So you've heard the phrase, or if you've choked, it's like, oh, it went down the wrong tube. That's actually pretty accurate. So in this picture, the epiglottis is right here. So it will somewhat cover up the windpipe or the trachea to make sure that the food does go down the correct tube, which is the esophagus, not the trachea. Speaking of the esophagus, what does it do? So it's about 20 centimeters long, which is only about 10 inches or so, and it includes secretion of mucus. It helps move the food. This is a very, very important vocab word. It's pronounced peristalsis. So when we eat food, we don't like, okay, esophagus, I'm going to squeeze you to my stomach. Okay, stomach, time for you to go to the small intestine. Our food is naturally moved by a process called peristalsis, and it's muscular movement, basically from your throat into your stomach, that will move the food along the digestive tract. Sometimes some of us might experience heartburn, and that is when the acid is actually going to kind of get into the esophagus, and we feel that, and it's called heartburn. So our response to that is to take like an antacid, or to take Tums, which would kind of take that acid from being an acid to more of a base or into water. All right, after the esophagus, we next go to the stomach, which is a huge landing spot for a lot of acids. There's a lot of bacteria in there, and a lot of the juices are the acids, as well as some of the enzymes that break it down. And then we also have bacteria in our body that naturally helps us out, but we also have an acidic environment that kills the bacteria that might otherwise get us sick. Another key vocab word is at the time that the food is in the stomach, it changes into what's called chyme. There's going to be a couple different words where we have chyme, we have bolus, and we have bowel as it goes down the digestive tube. So chyme is our first word, and it's basically kind of this liquidy type substance. There's some chunks in there, but that happens in the stomach. All right, the small intestine. This is, it's arguably the most important part of our digestive system, because this is where a lot of the actual absorbing of nutrients and the absorbing of the food is actually going to take place. And one of the main reasons why, or the reason why it is absorbing, is because it has a lot of what are called microvilli or villi. And these are, we've talked about them before, but they are little hair-like, finger-like projections that increase the surface area, and so that those nutrients, as well as water and other things, will be able to be absorbed. So the small intestine isn't really like a nice smooth tube, like what you would see, like a pipe. Instead, it's kind of got this tough network of stuff that food has to battle through. But that's on purpose. As it hits those microvilli, as it hits those folds and those bends and those kinks, that's where we're actually doing a lot of our absorption of those nutrients. And just to give you a context, your small intestine is about 20 feet long. So it's quite a network of those bends and kinks, but it does so because that's where a lot of the nutrients are actually going to be taken up. All right, so after the small intestine, a lot of the nutrients are taken up, so we got a lot of the good stuff out. So next, continuing, I guess, a little bit with the small intestine, so some stats. It's going to absorb some of the water, the vitamins, the minerals, carbohydrates, proteins. So again, it's going to absorb a lot of the food, but then the main thing that we want to take away is that it then is going to send it to the bloodstream. So as I mentioned opening, there's not an energy organ in our body. Every cell needs this nutrient. All the cells need blood. And so blood is what actually does the delivery of the food, sugars, nutrients, vitamins that the cells need. Okay, now let's go to the large intestine. And so here, there's not a lot of like the good stuff left. So here we're talking about a 4 to 5 foot long thing. So really what's happening here is that the large intestine will absorb some of the nutrients that that the small intestine didn't, but the main thing that it does is that it is going to really extract a lot of the water and concentrate the waste. So in other words, now we are creating a bowel. And a bowel, of course, bowel movement is what you're releasing into the toilet. And so there is some bacteria that also helps us out with this process. It, like I said, the main thing the large intestine does is that it's going to absorb water. And so when we release a bowel, that is why it's in solid form, generally speaking. Diarrhea is kind of another instance where that water is not being removed. Okay, so large intestine, small intestine have their own separate parts. So just make sure that we know the difference between them. Now, there's also some other stuff, what we call accessory organs, that are certainly part of digestion, but not necessarily in the GI tract. So that would include the liver, So what does the liver do? It's going to do a lot of like the detoxifying and take out some of the toxins in our food. The gallbladder is a component of the liver. The pancreas is going to help out with blood sugar levels and kind of how much sugar is in the bloodstream. So we've heard of those individuals that have diabetes and controlling the amount of water, sugar, and blood in their bodies. And the hormone insulin is a big role or has a big role in that. So specifically with the liver, it is going to produce a secretion called bile. Now, unfortunately, some of us have secreted bile after we vomited. It's kind of a yellowy type substance. And basically, that bile is going to help break down fat. Fat is a super complex molecule. It takes a lot of energy to break it down. And so bile is going to help break down those carbohydrate CH change. Not so not carbohydrates, the macromolecule, but the CH fatty acid chains that are in the fats. It also, as I mentioned, is going to filter out some of the waste or the toxins. And then also, if there's any type of alcohol, or if you eat anything with the toxins, it'll help take those out. The gallbladder is a part of the liver, kind of extension, and that is what actually stores the bile, and then we'll release it into the small intestine to again release some of more of those fats. And the pancreas is big with the sugar and blood concentration, and so insulin is involved, the hormone, and it's going to help produce also enzymes that are going to digest some of those things as well. And then insulin is the number one. So that is our short discovery on the digestive system.